今天这个讲演呢，这个我是想通过我的创作的一部分的创作的一个过程，然后呢，作为这个案例，分析呢艺术家自身所携带的文化基因是如何在艺术实践中呢被转换的，以及呢被使用的。
Today, I'd like to concentrate on my process of artistic creation in order to talk about how the energy of creativity is transformed into works of art.
我们的那个时间，因为这个，因为翻译的原因呢，就是我只能讲一半儿，是吧？啊，一半时间留给翻译，啊，所以我需要讲的比较简洁。啊、
Because of the limit of time, I have to be brief.
我们分我们分五个部分，啊。第一个部分呢，实际上是在就是说是这个题目了哈，基本是在我想谈一点，就是说这个，我们的这个就是说我们身上所携带这个传统文化的这个基因呢，它是怎么样被传递的，或者怎么样被接受的。
Today, I'd like to divide my talk into 5 sections.And first of all, I'd like to talk about how the cultural DNA in the Chinese tradition is passed down to the next generation.
对，因为呢，在我看来呢，就是中国的文化哈，它有一种特殊的一种性能。这种性能当然在其他的文化中也有，但是在中国的文化中呢，它好像表现得更强。
I see in the Chinese tradition a very strong characteristic.
我是觉得它有一种很强的这种修复性。
I think there is a characteristic of in that the culture can repair very quickly.
而且呢，它那个核心的部分哈，我是觉得它并不是通过文字和书籍的记载被传播的。
And I think the culture is not merely passed down through.Records found in books.
而是什么呢？而是通过这个，它是通过一种这个你周围人的这种行为和这个周围人的说话的语气和他们这个接人待物的处理的方法，被一代一代这样传承下来的。
That rather, I think the Chinese culture is passed down.From generation to generation through observance of the behavior and the language people speak in the daily life.
比如说这里面几张作品呢，是我在这个上美院之前，就是文革的后期，去这个农村插队的时期的作品。
For example, this piece of sketch was done when I work in the countryside. That was during the Cultural Revolution.
而实际上呢，当时在农村的这三年的生活，真的它让我身上呢，附带了很多的中国传统的民间文化的东西，以及呢，就是中国传统中诡异的东西。
In the 3 years when I stayed in a village,I was able to observe the Chinese folk culture as well as its uncanniness.
而这些被继承的东西呢，并不是农民们教我的，而是在我们共同的生活中我体会到的。
So I observed those folk culture from the farmers.
比如说我呢，我这人在家里是老三，就是我们家一共五个孩子，我在中间，所以呢我有哥哥姐姐弟弟妹妹。这种人呢，在中国的这个农村呀，就特别值钱，他叫权人。
In the countryside, there is a saying that a child like me, I am the third oldest child in my family, and they're saying that this is the so-called a complete person.
所以呢，在农村呢，他就要找这样的人呢，去给新结婚的人呢布置洞房和铺被子。
So a person like me is very useful at occasions such as when people decorate the new houses of a newlywed couple.
所以那时候呢，我就经常去 给这些农村啊去布置洞房啊，有点像做装置似的。其实当时我并不会做装置啊。
So I had a lot of experiences in decorating the new houses of the newlywed couples, and through that I made my very first installation art.
我布置洞房呢，最后呢让这个新娘新郎呢，他们就这个在这个繁殖后代上呢就可以非常的优秀啊。
So I think I contributed a lot to the fruitfulness of the newlywed couples.
因为我呢，因为我是属于这样一类人，我所以有这个作用。
Yeah. So I was very useful and functional.
我说这个东西是什么呢？就是实际上我们，我实际上在说这个中国这种文化，它是怎么样被存留在我们的 DNA 中的。比如说我们说孔子的学说，实际上孔子的学说呢是由他的学生，大量的是由他的学生记载了和他周游列国的时候他怎么样接人待物，他怎么样处理事情，他怎么样说话，或者他怎么样鞠躬行礼的这样的一些细节。
So come back to the topic about the cultural DNA in China. Take Confucius for an example. His behaviors and words were recorded by his students so that it can be passed down as a tradition to the Chinese people.
另外呢，我是想说这个，就是说在中国呢，由于这个社会主义时期和文革时期，所以呢，这个很多的传统文化呢是被隔断了的。
In the Chinese, in the 20th century history of China, we see a cultural dislocation due to the cultural revolution.
但是呢，在这个，但是在这个，但是在这个，但是在什么呢？在这个，我是觉得在这个，在比如说在文革的期间哈。就是或者说在社会主义的时期啊，它的很多的方式其实呢又是来自于非常深刻的传统的方法。
So during the Cultural Revolution or the so-called socialist period, people deal with things in daily life through a very traditional way.
比如说哈，比如说这个毛泽东啊，他在讲话里头啊，特别喜欢使用中国的典故。
For example, Chairman Mao likes to cite a lot of Chinese literary tradition when he talks.
比如他要鼓动这个人民呢，努力的工作，推翻什么三座大山，他就讲这个愚公移山的这个典故。
So, for example, when he tries to encourage people to work, he cites the story of愚公 who wanted to move the big mountain.
Yeah. 这个比如说这个他的这个比如说他的这个传播他的思想的方法，他其实是使用了最简洁的口号式的方法。
Chairman Mao knows how to use concise phrases or slogans to teach people about Chinese thoughts and methods.
比如说他对这个工业的这种政策，他就来一个工业学大庆。他对这个农业的政策，他就是农业学大寨。
For example, when talking about approaches or policies of in industry, he says we have to learn from the Daqing oil field. When it comes to agriculture, he says we have to learn from 大寨。
当然了，对部队呢，他就是说这个。全国人民学解放军，解放军学全国人民，这就是部队和一般人的关系。
In terms of the relationship between the People's Liberation Army and the people, he says they have to learn from each other.
Yeah. 但是这些东西呢，实际上呢，它是一种中国传统的非常有效的方法。比如说，这个中国的过去的这种。思想的传播都是通过《三字经》等等这样的朗朗上口的这个简洁的方式被传播的。
I think this comes from the Chinese tradition in that people often recite canons, for for example, the three character canons, it teaches people how to behave in daily life.
就是毛呢，大量的使用了传统中的有效的方法。
So Chairman Mao used a lot of those traditional methods.
Yeah. 比如说这个呢，是我在农村的时候呢，和农民和其他的知识青年一起做的这个文学刊物，就是用这个 mimeograph 这个制作的啊。
For example, on the slide, you can see one of the publications that I made with several urban youth who work with me in the countryside. We made this mimeograph magazine.
我呢其实是对这个政治呢并不敏感，但是我会画画和写字啊，所以我的任务呢就是把这些这个杂志呢 decoration 的特别的漂亮。
I wasn't particularly sensitive to politics, but I was able to draw and write very well, so I was able to decorate this magazine.
我们可以看到这些的题目都是非常简洁和朗朗上口的，它是非常有效的。
As we can see, the title of those articles are very concise and short, and thus very effective.
这些的这种所谓民歌呢，其实都是就是很古老的一种这种像那个经卷里的这样的说话的方法。
The genre is similar to the so-called folk songs, and you can find something similar in classical sutras.
用这些东西呢，其实不是为了继承传统，而是为了使用传统中有效的方法。
All these does not aim at replicating or succeeding the tradition, but find an effective way of spreading thoughts.
这个是我当时呢，因为我特别喜欢这些 decoration 啊，这些书法呀，这些美术字啊，这是我当时的一个剪贴本。
I like this kind of textual design, and I collected a lot of such clippings from newspapers and journals.
我们下面进入第二部分的几件作品。
Now I come to the section of my talk.
这个我想通过什么呢？通过一个就是说这个学院的教育，来谈就是我们的就是说中国的这个教育的传统，它是如何通过西方的学院教育的方式，得到体现的。
So I use this image as an example to talk about how the Chinese education system learned from the Western academy.
比如说这个我们其实中国的这个艺术教育呢，基本的核心的部分是学习了十九世纪的欧洲的这种素描的一个训练的方法。
So at art academies in China, we lay great emphasis on the training in sketchings that derives from the 19th century European art academies.
而中国的艺术家呢，在学习了如何把一个物象画得真实和立体的同时呢，实际上呢，我们又获得了对我们作为一个艺术家的人的质量的提升的一个收获。
During the process of learning how to represent the reality or an object, art students also learned how to become a better person.
Yeah. 实际上在中国呢，我们可以说，由于这个冷战哈，西方其实进入了现代艺术阶段。而并不那么重视十九世纪的或者古代的素描的训练，但是呢，社会主义国家，像中国和苏联，却一直延续了，就是非常严谨的十九世纪的训练方法。
Although China went through the Cold War, it still lays great emphasis on the tradition, from the 19th century European Academy.
那呢，就是说，在中国呢，就出现这样一个现象：中国艺术家是在全世界的艺术家中，在素描训练上花时间最多的一个国家。
In my opinion, Chinese art students spend the longest time in learning how to sketch.
但实际上呢，我因为在中央美术学院教素描教过很多年啊，最后我体会到呢，素描训练呢，实际它的目的呢，是让一个人从一个粗糙的人变为一个精致的人。
I taught sketching at the Art Academy for many years. And in my opinion, learning to sketch also teaches you to become a more refined person.
就是训练你呢，在一个整体的一个关系中呢，如何明察秋毫，而如何深入的能力。
It also teaches you how to observe the details and how to think in an in-depth and a critical way.
这些能力呢，是通过什么呢？是通过在画室里磨铅笔，我们都叫磨铅笔，你知道吧？像这样的作品呢，我们要画接近一个月啊，或者一个多月。就是我们在那儿磨铅笔，一点一点的把它给磨到我们认为是一个很像很立体的东西啊。
We use the term polishing the pencil to describe the diligence of how our students practicing sketching like this.
但实际上呢，后来我发现呢，其实中国人把这种西方的教育方法呢，转换成了和中国传统的教育方法核心的部分非常相似的。
In my opinion, this is an example how the Chinese turned a system that is originally Western into a Chinese value or method.
Yeah. 因为什么呢？因为这个，就是这个，比如说这个中国传统的教育方法哈，说到根儿上呢，其实它是什么呀？它是一种，就是说。通过不断的一种让你的重复和对你的训练而对你这个人的这个非常根本性的改造甚至包括生理的改造。
Through practicing, through such repetitive practicing, it actually changes you to become a better person.
比如说这个我们还说这个古代的孩子。读诗是吧？他其实并不懂这个诗，但是家长让他不断的学，不断的学，不断的背诵，不断的背诵。他将来掌握这个节奏以后，他一出口呢，就是有文化的。
In the past, Chinese people teach their children to recite classics, and at first the children didn't understand the content of the classics, but after they recited the classic for several times, they also received a kind of education.
Yeah. 包括中国书法的训练，比如我小的时候，我父亲让我每天写一篇大字，是吧？让做得很端正，而且那个其实就是一个，并不是让你把字写好看，而是让你按照中国传统的方式来发展自己。首先是要对文字的尊敬。
For example, my father taught me to practice and write a sheet of calligraphy every day. And the purpose is not in order to be able to write good calligraphy, but through this kind of method, I became to respect Chinese characters.
Yeah. 为什么中国讲童子功？童子功就是说你要从小练习，你才有效。为什么呢？就是说你从小练习呢？你的这个肌肉的发展都是不同的，所以呢，你一出笔呢，就是有文化的。
This is the so-called education since childhood. Through this kind of repetitive practicing, even your muscles get trained very well, and you will be able to write good calligraphy, perhaps.
这是中国教育的非常特殊的部分，是对人的生理的改造。就像今天呢，为什么中国的教育方式仍然是这个非常的这叫什么这种英式教育，或者说什么填鸭式教育？我们反复的跟家长说不要这样，但是问题是我们的传统概念就是要把孩子进行这样的教育，他将来才能够成为一个有文化的人。
So in my opinion, this traditional way of education is able to transform a person physically. And this kind of method of education that we sometimes call a British way of education receives a lot of critiques. But on the other hand, it also transforms the children into a more cultural person.
所以呢，这张图片呢，是我有一年呢，在这个 在牛津大学做的一个展览，是关于我的风景画的展览。所以呢，我这些风景画呢，和底下这些这个西方的大师的作品啊，做一个比照式的啊，的展览。最后，牛津大学的这个博物馆的这个绘画部的主任就说：“徐冰的这个素描画的真的是很好啊。”我觉得也不错，是因为这个古典的这个框子一箱哈、啊，觉得还是真的是很像样的。但是我跟他说呢。
So this is an installation shot of an exhibition at the Oxford University, which consists of several landscape sketches and drawings by myself. And then it was displayed along with some works by Western masters. And according to the director of the museum, I draw very well.
这个后来我说呢，我说在中国的只要是艺术学院毕业的学生都能画差不多这么好。
And I told the director that every art student who were trained at the Chinese Academy can do a good drawing like this.
就是说所有的中国艺术学院的毕业生呢，他的这个基因中呢都注入了一种同样的学院的基因。
So I see in every student or artist who was trained at an art academy in China, I see in them a kind of cultural DNA.
但是呢，现在的中国当代艺术的发展呢，这些艺术家呢，却发展成各种各样的和千奇百怪的。但是我们的基因都是一样的，在艺术的教育上，这就是一个问题和值得考察的内容。
I think there has been a lot of different kind of schools or development in the contemporary Chinese art scene, and I think this phenomenon is kind of I have a very critical view about this.
我们再进入第三个部分呢，是这个关于这个不同的自然观的这样的一些我谈一些看法啊，是通过三件作品。
In the third section, I want to focus on different concepts of nature through three different projects.
第一件作品呢是叫这个《芥子园山水卷》。
The first work is entitled The Mustard Seed Garden Landscape Scroll.
这件作品简单讲是怎么样弄的呢？它呢实际上是这个是把这个芥子园画传。里面的这些典型的画法、给它转移到这个我的一个长卷上。
So this piece of wood block is composed of different kinds of dots that you can find in the mustard seed garden manual. These kind of dots and strokes represent different kinds of leaves and plants.、嗯
这个芥子园画传在我们上学的时候呢 是受到批判的，但是我现在越来越觉得呢，这本书呢真的是非常重要，因为呢它这个非常固执的这个遗传了中国文化中非常核心的部分。
When I was an art student, this manual was criticized a lot, but I see this manual, it contains a lot ofcore values and methods of the Chinese culture.
Yeah. 比如说这个在中国文化中这个字典化或者说符号化或者说这个模板化真的是很重要的。在这一点呢那个雷德和教授的书呢其实给我们很多的启发。
A very distinct character of the Chinese culture and art is that the Chinese, we use a lot of symbols, and many representations are schematized, and this is also discussed in Professor Lederow's book.
这个比如说一个人怎么画，两个人怎么画，三个人怎么画，四个人怎么画，他是一个人叫什么独坐看花式，两个人就是二人看云式，他就把所有东西都变成式。
So this manual containslots of schema, such as how do you draw a single person or a group of two persons like this?
这个三个人就是三人对立式，四个人就是四人什么对饮式。你按这个方法去画，你就不会犯大错误。
So this applies to a group of three people or a group of four people, and if you master the way of drawing recorded in this manual, you can do a good drawing. 嗯，
我把呢这些字典上的这些式呢和这些模板式的画法，给它拼到了我的这个一幅作品中，而且再用中国传统的这种拔刀的方法给它刻出来。
So I transferred this kind of methods or patterns into woodcuts, and so I printed this scroll. 嗯，
这是由这个芥子园画展里头碎片碎片拼成的一幅山水画。拼完了以后，最后我惊讶地发现，不同的大家的画法拼在一起，它仍然是非常和谐的。
In this landscape.In woodcut, you can find different elements from different Chinese masters, but they actually look in harmony on this piece.
对，我们可以检查出中国的绘画是如何的程式化和概念化。
So this is an example how the Chinese art can be conceptualized, or how it is almost programmed.
这种模板画呢，确实也无时无刻的不反映在我们的生活中。
And this kind of schema or pattern can also be found in daily life.
嗯，比如说中国人说话呢，特别喜欢用四字成语。
For example, Chinese people like to use 成语 the four character phrases. Yeah,
这个不管这个事情如何复杂，但是呢，都喜欢给它。归到 四个字里面，比如说这个人不孝子孙，那不管这人怎么不孝子孙，这个就不管了，没关系，反正他属于这一类的人。
You can use different kinds of 成语, the four character phrases, to summarize a lot of complex concepts. For example, 不孝子孙 actually describes children who doesn't follow the Chinese rule for filial piety.But no matter how they are unkind to their parents, is not described in this phrase. 嗯，
当然我们还可以说这个，比如说现在的这种拷贝文化，就是说中国传统文化的中的拷贝文化，如何和现在的这个当代的这个版权法的冲突。
I also see a conflict between the traditional copycat culture or the culture of imitation or plagiarism and the modern laws.
Yeah. 这个其实这个拷贝文化呢其实也是和我上刚才讲的这种模板化其实有关系的。当然也是和中国文化中对传统的尊重也是有关系的。
So this copycat culture has something to do with theculture of using patterns of schema that I just talked about.
Yeah. 比如说这个比如说这个在这个现代的这个什么这种版权法的这个规定中呢就是说你不能够抄袭别人的著作中的内容超过 30% 还是25%等等的啊。
For example, in the current copyright law, it says that you shouldn't copy a text. You shouldn't copy over 30% of a text from other people.
但是呢，它后边有一注解，就是说这种要求呢，不包括中国的古体诗的创作。
But there is also a footnote saying that this regulation does not apply to classical poetry.
因为中国古体诗呢，特别讲究用典。用典是什么呢？就是说你用别人说过的句子来放在你的诗句里头。如果你用得好，说明你有文化，你的诗就好。
Because Chinese classical poetry lays great emphasis on citing classics, other classics or other masters.
下面我们再讲一个背后的故事。大家可能看过这个图片。这个呢背后的故事这件呢是在大英博物馆制作的它是复制的一幅王世敏的作品。
So now I come to my work background story and the piece that you can see on the slide right now is an imitation or it is inspired by a piece of painting by Chinese painter Wang Shiming, and it was down at the British Museum.
这件作品，就是说这个系列的作品呢，实际上是在差不多是15年以前就开始了。最早呢是在德国的 Darling Museum 创作的。
I actually started this series 15 years ago, and the first time it was made was at the museum Dahlem, the Museum for East Asian Art in Berlin.
因为这个博物馆呢，当时呢在二战的时候呢，有一个特殊的历史，就是他们有95%的作品呢被苏联红军给抢到圣彼得堡去了啊。所以呢，这段历史呢。和这个博物馆的特殊的这个展示空间呢，我就很想这个根据这样的一些条件呢来创作新的作品。
So this work was a reaction to the history of the Dahlem Museum. During the Second World War, 95% of its collection was seized by the Russian Red Army and transported to St. Petersburg.
我们看到的这幅作品呢，其实就是其中的一幅。我呢从中选择了三幅作品，用我的这个方法呢，把它们在这个美术馆再现出来。
I chose three paintings, three lost paintings by East Asian masters, and I tried to realize, reenact paintings through my own method.
这个时候呢，这些绘画呢，就像幽灵一样的，它仍然存在在这个美术馆。
So that those paintings can still exist in the museum like spirits.
为什么说它们像幽灵一样的？因为这些绘画呢，其实是不存在的，而是由光构成的。
Why I say they are like spirits? It is because the real physical painting actually don't exist there. These are paintings by the light.
我们呢，就是说把这个透明的这个美术馆的展柜。变成了这个 milky glass， 然后呢，我们呢在这个后面呢摆一些这些食物，这些食物包括 cardboard 呀、什么 branch 啊、这些垃圾啊、什么这些树枝等等。
The case or the vitrine you can see on the slide right now is made of milky glass, and behind the milky glass, I placed several objects such as cardboard or branches.
当这些物质呢和这个玻璃呢挨得很近的时候。从前面看呢，就显示出特别清晰的形象，而你给它一些距离的时候呢，它就很像中国绘画中的晕染一样的，它就变得模糊了。
If the objects are placed near the surface of the milky glass, looking from the front, the silhouette will look very sharp. However, if there is a distance between the objects and the surface, it creates a blurred effect, and if you look from the ground, it looks like a Chinese ink painting.
我们可以说呢，这个确实今天这光线不太清楚啊，效果不太那什么。但是呢，我们可以说呢，这是一种光的绘画。
So I think this is a painting of light.
而为什么要有光的绘画？因为呢，这个光呢，其实是最丰富的一种表达。
I think light is a very rich material and very expressive means.
因为它比任何的油画和国画的直接材料的绘画都要丰富。
It is richer than materials such as oil painting or Chinese ink.
Yeah. 这个是张大千的一幅画。
This is an imitation.Or a replication of a painting by Zhang Daqian.
我后来在想呢，就是说，我后来也在想，就是说，可以不可以用这种方法去再现欧洲的古典油画？但是我觉得是不可能的。
I keep wondering about whether I can use this method to reenact Western oil painting, but I think it might not be possible.
虽然呢，这个我用的都是实物，而欧洲的油画是写实的。
Although I think there's a connection between this method and the Western oil, in that Western oil are used for realistic painting.
这就给我们这个提出了一个问题，就是说这个中国绘画到底它的特殊性和西方的绘画不同在哪儿？
And that this makes me wonder the differences between the Chinese painting and the Western painting.
对，当然呢，很多的学者有过很多的研究和观点。
And different scholars have come up with different conclusions.
但是呢，这个我呢，由于为了做上边那个富春山居图，所以呢，我去年呢去了这个富春山，去考察这个黄公望的这个足迹。
In order to reenact a famous painting dwelling in the Fuchun Mountain by the Yuan Dynasty painter Huang Gongwang, I went to the Fuchun Mountain to observe the location.
在那一带呢，确实很多的风景画呢，真的是很像中国的山水画，特别是那些山峰的感觉，真的很像黄公望的那些山峰。
And I think the natural landscape there, especially the mountains, they look really like how Huang Gongwang depicted Fuchun Shan.
但是呢，你找不到任何一个山峰和黄公望的这个山峰是一样的。
But I couldn't find any mountain that looks exactly the same as how Huang Gongwang depicted it.
就是在中国的绘画中，其实有一个特点。就是呢，它表现一座山，这座山其实代表所有的山。它表现一棵松树，这棵松树其实代表所有的松树。而这一点呢，其实和西方的严谨的绘画不同。西方的绘画呢，特别是古典绘画，它画这样一个山或者这样一棵树，它实际上在表现某某某处的一座山和一棵树。
In my opinion, there is an essential difference between Western and Chinese painting in that when a European painter uses an oil painting to paint a mountain or a tree, it must have come from a real mountain or a real tree. But if a Chinese painter depicts a mountain, this represents every mountain.
Yeah. 这个，所以呢，这个，我用这些树枝在我的这个背后故事中，一个树枝其实它可以代表一棵树，而一个石头它可以代表一座山。
So in a background story series, whenever I use a branch, I use a branch to represent every single tree I see, and I use a piece of rock to represent different mountains.
最主要的是我在富春山的时候看到很多的风景真的很像中国的山水画的感觉。但是当我拿起相机照下来以后呢，最后我就觉得不好看，因为呢黑的地方特别黑，这个亮的地方特别亮，而且它变得特别的没有意境，变得太立体了。
Although I think the natural landscape at the Fuchun Mountain is really similar to a Chinese ink painting, the result of the photograph of Fuchun Mountain doesn't look artistic at all, and the dark parts are too dark, and the lighted parts are too light.
所以我就发现，其实中国的绘画呢，它是艺术家在随时调节自己肉眼的这个光圈，它不是光圈，它是什么瞳孔，随时调节瞳孔。他把暗的地方给看亮，他把亮的地方给看暗，这样呢，实际上中国的绘画它是一个。一个平的一个曝光板一样的。
Chinese painters are trained to see the nature differently, so they probably depict on their painting. They probably depict the light not so well lighted as they see in real life.
而这个欧洲的古典绘画呢，就是我们在上学的时候学的这个素描呢，实际上是要求把艺术家的眼睛。训练成照相机镜头的眼睛。
I believe the European painters were trained to depict the nature according to how a camera can catch.
就是说这个你要成为好的艺术家，你必须把自己的眼睛呢训练成和照相机的曝光的镜头，就是锁定光圈的一个镜头是一样的功能，就是它该暗的地方你不能够根据你的肉眼把它调节成亮的。虽然那时候还没有照相机，但是呢欧洲的绘画的方法已经发展成了这样的一种要求。
In this sense, Western painters are trained to see and paint scientifically just as a camera can do.
这个其实解释了为什么背后的故事这样的方法无法复制这个欧洲古代的油画。
This probably explains why I cannot use the method that I applied in background story to replicate Western oil painting.
其实我的很多作品呢都是给自己创造一个条件，在过程中呢让我发现我们这个文化中到底有哪些东西是特殊的和我们不认识到的。
In my process of working, I usually give myself a chance to discover how the tradition was, how to utilize the tradition.
这个系列呢，其实在世界各地做了不同的尝试，而且呢，它确实有这个新的进展啊。现在看到这个呢，是在台北的，就是王家骥教授策划的这个展览里面的一件很大的作品，我们使用了。台北美术馆的建筑本身的大窗户。
So this is an installation view of one of the background story work exhibited at my retrospective at the Taipei Fine Art Museum, and this is curated by Jason Jiaji Wang. I utilized this work is site specific. I used the windows from.The Taipei Fine Art Museum to make this work.
观众从外面看呢，是这个是一幅巨大的董其昌的绘画，但是呢，走到这个美术馆里面呢，最后可以看到，它是由这些现成物所构成的。
Standing in the courtyard of the museum, the audience can see an installation work that looks like a painting by the Chinese painter 董其昌。But if they stand in the exhibition room of the museum, they can see the natural debris.
Yeah. 我们呢同时在室外做过一个试验，就是我们把一个巨大的玻璃，毛玻璃是吧，和这个树林呢紧紧的推在一起。
I also did this experiment in open air, and I placed several trees behind the milky glass.
我这儿有一个。这个吧，这个好像这个不是，这个好像是，啊、哦、对不起，这样，这是一个短短的一个延时摄影，就是由于这个自然的变化和四季的变化，所以这幅画上的这些光线呢就变得非常的丰富。
So this is a video documentation of this work, and you can see the change of light.
就是我们用一种方法把现实中的三维的一个空间给它压扁了。
Yeah, so in this case, I transform a three-dimensional space into a two-dimensional work.
对这个呢，我做展览呢，我喜欢把这个 education 这部分做得非常的有意思。这个呢是我们 education 的这个部分，它就有一点像这个一个像芥子园画传似的，对吧？它告诉你这些东西是由什么材料做出来的，比如说这个下面，下面就是这些麻丝，然后这就是这样的一些树枝和树叶，对吧？
So this is the educational part of the project, and if you can, the details show there are hands and silk in it.
对，然后孩子呢可以用他们 自己的材料，然后做了他们的一些用这样的方法做一些东西，然后可以体会到这个艺术创作的一种乐趣。
So the children can use those material to make works by themselves.
其实中国的教育方法和中国的绘画呢，比如说刚才我们谈到的《芥子园画传》要我看呢，《芥子园画传》呢就像一本字典一样的。其实呢，它是记录了表达世界万物的偏旁部首。
So in my opinion, the mustard seed garden manual is like a dictionary that records different radicals of the world.
你呢画画呢不是靠练的，是靠记的。你只要记住这些偏旁部首，你就可以用这些偏旁部首去描绘你心中的万物。所以中国讲纸抄纸。
As long as you memorize all the radicals and all the patterns, and you will be able to paint very well. So there is a saying in Chinese that you can copy from paper to paper.
所以我们这个背后的故事，这个教育的体系呢，它有点像我们把这个魔术给你展示了以后，最后呢再告诉你这个魔术是怎么弄出来的。
So this educational part of the project is like is similar to after you've done a magic, you explain to the public how the magic was done.
在这一部分呢，我还有一件作品呢，叫这个桃花源的理想一定要实现。
So here is the work entitled 桃花源。A village utopia, and which can also be literally translated into the peach blossom spring.
Yeah. 这个是在这个英国那个 V&A 这个院子里做的啊。
This is down in the courtyard of the Victoria and Albert Museum in London.
这个作品呢，实际上是在探讨我们今天的人类与自然达到了前所未有的紧张的程度的问题。
So this work deals with the nervous relationship between the human beings and the nature nowadays.
实际上到那个 V&A 他那个大院子里有一滩椭圆形的湖水，这滩湖水我看了以后呢，真的我觉得这滩湖水特别珍贵，我就很想用这滩湖水做一个作品。
There is a lake in the courtyard of the V&A Museum, and I see when I saw it, I find it very precious, and really want to do a project about it.
是因为什么呢 ？V&A 这个欧洲古典的大院子，这个之外呢，是这个代表这个欧洲工业文明的一个当代化的城市。
V&A Museum is almost a symbol of a contemporary industrial society.
所以呢，这滩湖水就显得特别珍贵。
So, because of that, I think the lake in the courtyard of the museum is really precious.
所以我们呢找到了九种不同的类型的石头，做了一个像中国山水长卷一样的，它呢基本上可以对位不同种的中国的山水画的风格。
So we collected 9 different kinds of rocks, and each rock is responding to a style of Chinese ink painting.
这些石头呢，我们都是找的是扁扁的石头，因为呢，我想造成一个二维半的一个概念的场景，就是说它是现实，但是我们非常想进入，但是又无法进入。
I deliberately collected rocks which are flat because I wanted to create an effect of a 2.5-dimensional object. So on the one hand, it is realistic, but on the other hand, the audience cannot enter the work.
比如说这是一些石头的局部，我们可以看到真的很漂亮。
This is a detail of a rock.
这也是 detail of the rock. 我觉得这个 我觉得这个风格呢，很像贾又福的风格。
I think this rock reminds me of the style of a Chinese ink painter whose name is 贾又福。
这个局部呢，真的就很像陆延绍的风格。
And this looks like 陆延绍 style。
所以呢，我就觉得中国古代的绘画呢，他们从自然中确实是吸取了很多的审美的经验。
So I think Chinese classic painting actually learned from the nature.
因为呢，那时候不像现在是又有手机，有微信，有那么多东西可看。那时候天一黑就没什么事可干了。
In the ancient times, people didn't have iPhone and WeChat, so after the sunset, they didn't have anything to do.
所以呢，画家呢，他可以把一个石头或者一个自然的局部，他可以观察到极其的深入。
So the painters spent a lot of time observing the details of rocks.
所以中国有赏石的这个传统。
That's why in China there's a tradition of observing or viewing the rocks.
我们呢，工作室的团队呢，就是用各种各样的手法制造了一个我们理想中的桃花源。
So my studio used our own method to recreate an utopia.
实际上，我希望人们看到这个作品呢，反省的是我们人类今天的现实的生活环境。
Actually, through this work, I want to remind people of the reality and the environment in our life today.
在这个我们用那个陶哈，我们用陶做了很多的小的房子。这些房子呢，大一点它就扁一点，它要小一点它就高一点，里头的空间都是差不多的，它是平等的。
So we created a lot of these small ceramic houses, and the spaces they are the spaces inside are all the same.
这个里面呢，用这个小的这个 screen， 然后呢，反映的都是。这个幸福的生活。
And I inserted little screens with animations in it, and the animations all represent happy life.
实际上呢，这个，这个是这个作品呢，后来是在 V&A 展览完了以后，又移到了英国的那个 Chatsworth House。
So after it was exhibited at the V&A Museum, it was moved to the Chatsworth House, also in the Great Britain.
在那儿真的是很漂亮的。
It's a very beautiful garden.
和我的作品。
This is my work.
这个这些村庄和这个山里头呢，其实是很多的山洞啊什么的，其实有很多的人的这个活动啊。
So I created a lot of caves and human activities in this installation.
实际上是和这些鸟啊和这些动物啊，都是生活在一起的。这些狮子和这些羚羊等等的，全都生活在一起，它没有冲突。
In this installation, human beings and animals, including Lions, they live in harmony with each other.
因为其实中国这个功夫这个领域哈，其实特别讲究什么？特别讲究人要和生灵是平等的。所以呢，这个功夫 master 就讲究什么呢？我在这一练功，我周围就会围过来很多的鸟啊、狐狸啊什么的、兔子呀、什么的这些生灵。
So in the Chinese Kung Fu, there is a saying or a thought that human beings are equal to animals. So when one performs Kung Fu, actually all the animals surrounding you will be attracted.
你达到这个境界呢，就说明你的功夫非常厉害。
If you can reach this level, it means that you have mastered Kung Fu.
这个我其实在这儿呢，我想讲一个，就是说传统和当代的一个关系。实际上呢，就是说这个，我理解这个当代和传统呢，其实它不是对立的，而且它也不是由时间段来区分的。实际上呢，它是传统还是当代，其实它是由这个一个特殊的语境来决定的。
So here, I'd like to say that my view about the tradition and the contemporary culture is that I don't see them as oppositional to each other, and they shouldn't be seen as two separate epochs.
Yeah, 它有点像一个磁场似的，就是像一个磁场，它是相互随时转换的。
They can be compared to a magnetic field, which can be transformed.
比如中国传统中的非常优秀的部分，就是天人合一，或者说敬畏自然。
A brilliant thought in Chinese culture is that we emphasize the harmony between the human beings and the nature, as well as the reverence of nature.
但是这样的思想呢，在一二百年以前呢，其实就是一个落后的，或者说一个反动的思想。
So this kind of thought, one or two hundred years ago, this kind of thought was deemed to be too revolutionary.
因为那个时候呢，人类的文明呢，其实是总体上呢，都是在发展工业文明，而改造自然，而解决人类的一个生存的问题。
That was the time of the industrialization, and human beings were aiming at transforming the nature or conquering the nature.
Yeah. 但是呢，那时候呢，你整天是说天人合一，或者说敬畏自然，我什么都不干，我觉得就是一个不正确的思想。
At that time, the Chinese thought of living in harmony with nature probably was inappropriate.
但是呢，资本主义文明发展到现在，它开始里面出现了问题，而让我们与自然的关系呢，达到了一个前所未有的一个紧张的程度。
Today, in the capitalist society, we see a huge tension between human and nature.
所以呢，这个时候呢，天人合一的思想就成了最当代的思想和最具有未来性的思想。
At this time, I think the thought of living in harmony with nature is very contemporary and even futuristic.
因为呢，这种思想呢，虽然是一个古老思想，但是呢，它可以补充和调节人类文明发展到今天所出现的弊病的部分。
This is, of course, a very old or traditional thought, but today it is able to transform or change or solve the problems of people's life.
下面一个部分呢，我比较快的要讲一下，就是说是这个一些会变异的一些作品。
I'm going to quickly go through several works that are ephemeral.
其实在九三年前后呢，我那时候觉得这个，因为我参与了西方的当代艺术创作，我开始觉得就是说，我的这个创作动力和这个创作灵感呢，好像特别枯竭。
Around 1993, I participated in I did a lot of contemporary artworks, and at that time I felt like I couldn't find my inspiration anymore.
所以呢，我当时呢，其实就想到呢，就是是不是可以借助活的动物，来这个补充呢人类的这种想象力的匮乏。
So I sought spirit or inspiration in living animals.
所以呢，我其实当时做了几个系列的作品。这个系列呢，就是在美国养蚕系列。
This is a series called Keeping Silkworms in America.
其实是，比如这个是蚕子，然后呢做的一本书，它在这个展览的时候呢，这些黄色的东西它会变成黑的，然后呢，就是它在展览的时候，这些小虫会孵化出来。
So I made a book like this out of silkworms, and during the course of the exhibition, the silkworm eggs were transformed into silkworms, and they would start to spin cocoons.
这一部分呢是这个蚕呢在吐丝的时候呢，它们在 cover 一些毒物。这些毒物开始的时候呢，展览的时候是可以读到的，但是到展览结束的时候，这些东西被被锈给 cover。
At the beginning of the exhibition, the text printed on the publications were still legible, but through the time, the silkworms would spin cocoons and cover the text, and they became illegible.
这个是把一个 VCR 的盖子打开以后，我让那个蚕在这个 VCR 里面做茧。但是有意思的是，这个 VCR 仍然工作，所以我把它连到了一个 monitor 上面。
In this work, I place silkworms in a VCR machine, and it is interesting that the VCR machine was still working. And I connected the VCR to a monitor so that you can see the silkworms on the screen.
这件作品呢，我其实做完了以后收获挺大的。就是这件作品呢，实际上是用这个 mulberry leaf, mulberry tree 插成了一束花。但是我把上面放了很多的那个 silkworm。这个 silkworm 在开幕的时候呢，它吃这些桑叶。
In this work, I place a bundle of mulberry leaves with a lot of silkworms in a vase, and after several days, the mulberry leaves were eaten by the silkworms, and then transformed this work into arrangement of cocoons.
Yeah, 但是过了一两天呢，这些蚕呢就开始做茧，然后呢。这一簇，葱绿的这束花呢，最后就变成了一个干枯的，和这个由金色的茧和银色的茧构成的，一束花。
And thus that transformed a bundle of green mulberry leaves into an installation made of gold and silver cocoons.
其实这件作品呢，给我很多的启发，就是如何用中国的古代的哲学。或者说禅的思想来处理当代艺术。
And this is the first time I realized how I may utilize or apply the Chinese Chan Buddhism thinking into works of art.
下面一件作品呢叫《何处惹尘埃》。
This is a work entitled "Where Does the Dust Itself Collect?"
这件作品呢也被很多人认为呢是非常有中国的。方法的作品。
A lot of people think that this work represents a work made of Chinese culture and method.
刚才那件照片呢，是我在纽约的工作室的前面，我看着这个911这两个大楼倒下来的。
The previous slide shows a photograph that I shot in front of my studio. That was the time when the Twin Towers started to collapse during the 911 event.
作为一个艺术家，面对这样的一个现场，你能做什么呢？后来我呢就去纽约的下城呢，收集了一包灰尘。
I didn't know how to react facing this scenario, so I went to the Manhattan. I went to Manhattan to collect a bag of dust.
我呢作品呢实际上是把这些 dust 吹到展厅，然后在然后这些灰尘呢会落在这个地板上。在之前呢，我们给它放了这个 stencil， 然后等落定以后呢，灰尘落定以后，我们再给它移开，就显现出了这样的两行字。
In this installation, I placed stencils on the floor, and then I blew the dust into the room, and that created the sentences on the surface of the floor.
这件作品呢，看上去非常的漂亮，非常的美，很安静，但实际上又给人一种很紧张的感觉。
The effect of this installation is very beautiful, but it also makes you feel nervous.
因为好像一阵风吹过以后呢，整个世界就要变化。
This work is very fragile, and it can be destroyed by a blast of wind anytime.
实际上，这件作品呢，它是在谈，并不是谈911事件本身，而是在谈精神世界和物质世界之间的关系。
So this work is not directly reacting to the 911 event. It deals with the relationship between the spiritual world and the material world.
这个呢是我把这些尘埃如何从纽约带到威尔士的一个过程，因为呢最早这件作品在威尔士完成的。
This slide shows how I transported the dust from New York to Wales.
实际上你带着911的尘埃是很难过关的。所以呢，我给它做成了一个小的一个人形。我带着这个人形到了威尔士。
It would be difficult to pass the custom with a bag of dust from the 911 event. So I cast a toy doll out of the dust.
嗯，然后到威尔士呢，我们又给它碾成了一个粉末，最后呢，给吹到展厅里面。
And in Wales, I ground them back to dust and blew them into the insulation.
嗯，这件作品展览之后呢，其实我收到过一封信，我觉得很有意思，是美国的一个美国历史博物馆在加州那边，他呢就说，听说你收集了一些尘埃。我们呢是有一部分是讲这个911这个事件的，但是我们忘记了收集这些尘埃，我们收集了救火队员的这些 jacket 呀、和这些死难者的 license 等等的。他说你能不能卖给我们一点这个灰尘
？After I made this project, a museum in California contacted me. They were making an exhibition about the 911 event. They collected the jackets of firefighters, but they forgot to collect the dust, so they asked me if I could sell them some of the dust.
嗯，我说这个东西好像是没法卖。
I think it would be difficult to sell things like this.
但是这件事呢，也给我一些启发，就是说，不同的价值观和这个由于政治和资本的这种左右，其实我们忘却了很多。人类最基本的概念和常识的东西。
So this makes me think that because of today's politics and capitalism, a lot of old values are already lost.
Yeah. 但实际上呢，其实在基督教，或者说这个犹太教，包括中国的佛教。实际上对尘埃的态度呢，就是在原教义上其实都是一样的。
And I think a lot of religions such as Christianity, Judaism, and Buddhism, they have similar concepts toward the dust.
Yeah. 当然呢，这个作品的变异性在哪儿呢？就是说，我们每次展览完了以后呢，过了两三个月以后，我们再用那个 vacuum 再把这个灰尘再吸回来，然后用下次再展览用。但是这个时候呢，就是每一次展览以后呢，这些尘埃中呢就会混杂了这个城市的尘埃。
After each installation, we have to collect the dust back through a vacuum machine, and each time we also collected the dust from different cities.
嗯。下面呢，最后一个部分呢，我不知道我们的时间怎么样，这个不对的。胡老师，我们的时间可以吗？好。对，我下边再讲一部分这个跟文字有关系的啊。
So now I'm going to talk about some works that are made of text.
对，实际上是从天书到地书，中间又有一个部分是新英文方块字。
I'm going to talk about book from the sky to book from the ground.
我简洁地说一下这个作品，因为大家可能也比较了解。其实这个作品呢，它使用了这个特别的中国的这种声东击西的方法。为什么这么说呢？是因为我好像在说这个事儿，其实我在说别的事儿。
A characteristic of the Chinese culture is that sometimes we talk about one thing, but it appears that we're talking about one thing, but in fact we're talking about another thing.
实际上呢，就是说我在非常认真地做一本书，可实际上呢，这个所谓的书其实不能管它叫书，因为呢，它不具备书的本质的功能。
So, in Book from the Sky, it appears that I was seriously making a book, but it is actually not a book because it doesn't have a functions of a book has.
我好像在谈论文字。但实际上呢，这些看上去非常像文字的字，实际上都是伪汉字，而它和文字的实质是没有关系的。
It seems that I created a lot of characters, but they are all faked characters, and they have nothing to do with the real Chinese characters.
而实际上它使用的呢是文字的外壳的部分。怎么讲？就是说这个东西就像一个食品，被包装得非常漂亮。这个食品本身呢，其实是没有文化内涵的，而是被消费的。
So I adopt the appearance of real Chinese characters to make this work, which appears to be very beautiful, but in fact there's no content in it.
Yeah. 但是这个包装呢本身是有文化含义的。
But the way I decorated or I wrapped this work actually has some meaning in it.
因为文字的功用性本身其实它是非常世俗的，而是被世俗滥用的。
I think the function of text or characters are actually very secular or they are abused by secular purposes in this world.
所以呢一个学者呢他其实看了最早的天书以后呢他就说哦我感觉到了文字的尊严。
So that's why one of the scholars who saw a book from the sky told me that he saw in this work very respectful characteristic of text.
对，实际上呢，这个中国的书法哈，它的非常重要的一个部分，就是它使用的和讨论的，其实不是书法的内容本身，而是书法的一个包装。
什么东西？
一个包装，就是一个外包装，实际上啊，我们讨论的都是书法的外包装，其实，而跟它的。这个表达的内容是没有关系的。
So in Chinese criticism about calligraphy, we usually talk about the appearance of calligraphy itself, but there's nothing about the content.
而中国文化的其实中国书法的中国书写的一个特殊性的东西，它真的是有这样的一个特点。
And that's one of the characteristics of the Chinese calligraphy.
这个我也要谈到这个雷德侯教授昨天晚上送给我那本书我大概读了一下真的很精彩、啊、其实都是在探讨这个我不知道您是不是同意我的这个谢谢
So Professor Head Letterose gave me a book about calligraphy yesterday、
这个就不说了这个啊下面我们再说一下这个英文方块制这个系列作品。
Now I'm going to talk about the series, English Square Calligraphy.
这个作品呢，实际上它是戴着面具的这些文字，是吧？给我们一个熟悉的面孔，或者陌生的面孔，但是呢，它里面呢，确实和外表是截然不同的。
This work presents a kind of text that is a text that wears a mask because its appearance is very different from its content.
实际上我在展览的时候呢，我是把这个画廊改成了一个书法教室。
So I transformed the gallery into an English calligraphy classroom, English Square calligraphy classroom.
这个时候呢，其实为什么这样处理这个作品，这又涉及到我自己的一个背景和传统。
So the reason why I made this work comes from my experience with the Chinese culture.
其实那个时候我已经开始意识到当代艺术中的弊病就是与这个一般人之间的关系的一个问题。
I was aware of the drawbacks of the contemporary art at the time.
所以呢我就很希望我的作品呢能够是平易近人的能够是让一般的人能够进入的而进入以后呢他会发现原来这个作品是与众不同的。
I wanted my work to be understood by a wider audience.
当然呢，这一部分呢，就是说艺术与社会与人的一个互动的关系。在今天不深讲，我们在这个最后一场讲演的时候，会有几件作品来深入的探讨这个问题。
And so this concerns the relationship between art, the society, and human beings. And now I'm not going to go in deeper into it, and this will be the topic of my third talk.
这个 installation 呢，我很希望它有点像这个。有点像那个扫盲运动的这样的一种感觉。
So this installation aims at making the text more accessible to a wider public.
这是这个教科书了。
This is the textbook I made.
我后来就成了书法家了。这个很多人让我题字。
Now I also became a calligrapher, and many people asked me to write calligraphy for them.
因为呢，其实我从来没有认为我父亲让我写字是让我成为书法家。
I didn't think that my father wanted me to become a calligrapher.
这些都是这个《春江花月夜》，就是中国的古诗，然后翻译成了英文，然后又被我写成了一个方块字的形式。
This is a poetry, a Chinese poetry translated into English, and I put the English version into this piece of work in English square calligraphy.
这个是因为这种形式呢，其实它可以运用于任何的拼音文字啊。这个呢，其实是德文的。
This way of writing actually applies to all kinds of languages or texts that are that use alphabets. And this is a work made of German square calligraphy.
这个是当时在这个纪念柏林墙倒塌的那个一活动中，我其实是写在参加了一个大的活动，所以我写在一个那个石板上。
This is a work that I did on a stone plate, and it was created at the occasion of a celebration of the fall of the Berlin Wall.
这个是我来之前其实给一个杂志写的一个这个提了一个字了。这个是我们可以读，其实是大家能读吧？这是 I N T E R N A T I O N A L International， 可以吧？哈，其实很容易读的。这个是 B U S I N E S S
Business
Club， 这是 Club C L U B 啊，这是我的那个。sign 签名，所以这个我觉得我们有中文的概念，我们也有英文的概念，但是面对我这样的书法，其实我没有一个现成的知识概念来面对它。
So we have the concept for Chinese, what Chinese is, and the concept for English, what English is. But facing this kind of calligraphy, these kind of concepts are deconstructed.
Yeah, 这个所以呢，这个。就是什么呢？就是说，这个我们必须要扩展我们的思维和知识的范畴，而建立一个新的概念来面对这样的书法。
So facing this kind of calligraphy, we have to expand and we have to go beyond our habitual way of thinking.
实际上我的艺术呢，我很希望对人的思维有所改变。这种改变在于什么呢？就是说，给你的习惯的思维。制造一个障碍，而就像计算机死机了一样。
Through my art, I hope, I will be able to transform the habitual thinking of human beings. And I always wanted to create a barrier, for, people's thinking and viewing.
这就像中国禅宗的棒喝和公案的作用是一样的。
This is similar to, the koan found in.Chan Buddhism.
所以我在前两年其实收到过一封澳大利亚教育部的信。澳大利亚教育部就说，你能不能同意我们把你的这样的书法放在我们新的 IQ 测验的这个系统里面
？The Ministry of Education in Australia actually contacted me. They wanted to put the system of writing into their curriculum.
最后一个作品，我再讲一下这个《Dishu》这个作品。
I'd like to talk about book from the ground, and this is the last work I'm going to talk about today.
这个作品呢，它实际上是用这些 icon 写成的。
This book is written in icons and emoticons.
所以呢，它就成了一本超越于地域文化和超越于知识等级的一本什么人都可以读懂的书。
So this is a book that everybody in different cultural background will be able to read.
而且是一本在什么地方出版都不用翻译的读物。
And it can be published anywhere without being translated.
现在已经有了各种版本，什么韩国的版本，什么什么什么意大利的版本，什么英国的版本，什么等等各种各样的俄罗斯的版本马上要出来啊。
It is already published in Korea, Italy, England, and will be very soon published in Russia.
这个，其实我是这个 作品呢，其实在很多年以前就开始了，差不多有15年以前就开始了。那时候呢，我其实看到口香糖上的一些小的标志，它讲了一个小故事，所以我觉得用成千上万的这些标志，一定可以写一个长篇的故事出来。
This project started 15 years ago when I saw small drawings printed on a piece of wrapping paper for chewing gums. And I thought, why don't I create a book made of those icons?
但是那时候呢是写不出来的，因为那时候没有这么多的 icon 和这个表情符。但是这些年呢，这个 icon 和表情符实在是发展得太迅猛了。
At that time, I wasn't able to finish this book because there weren't so many icons and emoticons. But nowadays, there is an incredibly rich production of emoticons with the internet.
我们现在打开手机，我们读的都是 icon.
Nowadays, when we turn on our iPhone, and all we see is emoticons.
所以我就说，今天呢，可以说是新一轮的象形文字开始的时期。
So I think we are in an age of a new age of the pictorial language.
因为我们的世界真的成了一个村子，一个村子呢，却说着各种各样奇奇怪怪的文字和各种各样的符号。实际上，今天呢，这个巴比伦塔的这个所指向的含义呢，才真正的被激活。
So this, I think that we are in an era where we see the new Tower of Babel reenacted. And there are different kinds of languages and texts invented in the world village today.
这些都是我们在这个十多年来一直的一个试验。最后这个书呢，在这个4年以前差不多出版。
So after a long time of experiments, this book was published.Finally published 4 years ago.
对，最早是在台湾出版的。
It was originally published in Taiwan.
这个书呢是一共24个章节，一个章节呢，等于是一个小时，说了一个人一天24小时的生活。
The book consists of 24 chapters, and each chapter stands for an hour in a day of a person.
这个其实是很容易读的。
It's actually very easy to read.
对，我们可以如果试着读的话，这个人去了洗手间，然后呢去上厕所，但是好像有点什么问题。
So we can try to read this. So this person went to the bathroom in the morning, and he's getting into some trouble in the toilet.
然后他在想 some problem, my stomach. My stomach. 然后呢？他在那等着是吧？然后就是这个玩手机开始。
He was waiting, and then he was playing his iPhone.
Oh, he got it, right?
And he finally made it.
对，然后呢？对，然后我们都要回去看一眼，对吧？然后是 flush.
And then he looked at the toilet and he flushed.
Yeah. 像这些，我们有一个原则，就是这所有的符号都不是我们自己创造的，而都是收集来的。因为收集来的符号呢，带有语言的种子的性质。
These are all found emoticons and symbols, and because I see in those emoticons a characteristic of language and text.
这是我们展览的一个情况。我们展览是把我们的工作室的这部分移到展厅去。我们想说明的是，这些材料是。正在发展中的材料，所以这项工作是一个没完没了的工作。
So, we actually moved our studio into the installation space in order to show that the work is still under development.
同时，我们呢有一个软件，这个软件呢，你打中文进去，它就会变成 icon 的 language.
We also developed a software in which whichever kind of language you enter, it will generate a kind of language made of emoticons.
然后我们还有英文的，所以呢，这个时候呢，中文和英文就可以借助这个软件呢， 进行一个简单的一个交流。
So in this way, two different people speaking using English and Chinese can will be able to communicate with each other.
Yeah. 所以呢，我是想说呢，比如说这个图片呢是在十年以前在 MoMA 展览的，它是在玩这个软件，但是呢，它是一个就是探讨这个艺术家如何面对新科技的这样的一个最前沿的一个展览。
So this installation shot was at a show that I did 10 years ago at MoMA, and what I wanted to explore is how an artist react upon the new technology.
Yeah. 但实际上呢，我这儿想说呢，这个虽然非常当代的艺术作品，但真正的实际的来源呢，就是灵感的来源，其实是来自于我身上所携带的中国的这个读图的一个传统，或者说中国文化中对符号的一个特殊的认识的这样的一个传统。
I think this all comes from the tradition of reading a picture.In the Chinese tradition, and also the characteristic of symbolism in the Chinese culture.
我最后想说的是什么呢？就是说，在每一种文化中，其实都有非常优质的和非常劣质的部分。
I think I see in each culture the some positive sides and also some drawbacks.
但是我的创作和我的工作呢，其实我是希望通过我的实践。来体会和挖掘在我自己的这个文化背景和传统中呢到底有什么东西是有价值的是特殊的是可以用的。
Through my artistic practice, I actually want to dig out the positive side of the Chinese culture, what I as a Chinese artist can utilize for my work.
Yeah. 但是呢这个对于中国的文化来说呢，我们的问题是，就是说，一个是其实是没有真正的挖掘这个文化中到底有什么东西。另外呢，问题来自于，即使我们知道我们的文化中有非常好的东西，但是如何使用它，其实我们是没有这个经验的。
I think there are two major problems in today's China. First of all, there's a lack of understanding.And exploration of the Chinese tradition. And secondly, I think we actually don't know how to utilize it.
对，因为呢，我们有使用西方文化的经验，但我们却没有使用我们自己文化的经验。因为过去的一二百年呢，其实，由于这个西方文化的这种，它对人类的文明的进展所起到了重要的作用，而证明它是有效的，在那个时期。所以呢，全世界的人民，这个在西方中心之外的人们都在关注着西方的文化，所以我们把大量的精力都用在如何学习西方的文化上。
In the past several centuries, because the Western culture has been a leading culture in the world, the Chinese have learned how to utilize or learn from the Western culture.
对，但是我们需要做的是。积累如何使用自己文化中好东西的经验和怎么使用。
But in my opinion, we also need to learn how to, we also need to develop an understanding of our own Chinese culture and how to utilize it.
这个是我大概的讲演的一个结束。我不知道时间还有没有。如果有呢，我这还有几个，幻灯片。那咱们就今天就到这儿，因为下边两场还有。时间，谢谢大家。
Thank you so much.
We 应该谢谢那个我们的出色的翻译雨杰。